The scripture verse is taken from Revelation chapter 22, verse 12. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. So I stand here today, not out of my own righteousness, for in all of my righteousness, it is accounted by God as filthy rags. I stand here today as a sinner saved by grace, because I believe that Jesus Christ is the only means to salvation, the only way to God the Father. I believe that He is God who came to this world. He is God who died for my sins, for your sins. He took my place on the cross. I believe that He is going to come back one day. And when He comes, we will reign with Him. We will serve Him. We will be with Him. That is why, and that is what I believe. So I stand here as a sinner to save by grace. I also stand here with a roller coaster of emotions. On one hand, it's an awesome appreciation that I, an unworthy sinner, could bring to His people the Word of God, which is infallible. I stand here on one hand with awesome appreciation. On the other hand, I stand here with apprehension, with fear that the words not be my very own, but the words be from God, that you will hear Jesus Christ speaking through me, and that I will be nothing more but a pipe, a conduit, and that there will be nothing in me, the evil, the wickedness that is in me, that will block that word from coming. And I also stand here with great anticipation, because the Word of God says that His Word will not return without accomplishing its course, as said in Isaiah 55:11. So I stand here that God will be at work as His Word comes to His people, to you and to me. And so my prayer, I said three prayers before this message. My prayer first is for myself. The supplication I have for myself is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18 and 19, which says, if any man over here seems to be wise, let him become a fool. So I pray, Lord, make me a fool, because the wisdom of this world is foolishness before God. And then I said a prayer for each one of you, that you be like the Bereans. As said in Acts chapter 17, verse 11, for whom it was said that they were commendable because they searched the scripture daily to see if what the disciples were saying was true or not. So don't take my word for it. Go and search the scripture daily. And then I said a prayer for each of us, for you and me. And that prayer was that we will not listen just with our ears, but we will listen with our hearts. That we will not respond with our lips, with lip service unto God, saying, I will do this for you, or I will be like this going forward. Or we will respond truly with our lives. My prayer for this church today, including myself, was that we will hear, and not just hear, but we will heed. And with that said, let me start what the Lord has given unto each one of us today. I'm going to tell you a story of a man who was born in 1905. This man, when he died in 1976, and he was born in Humble, Texas, the other say it was in Houston, Texas. When he died in 1976, his net worth was in the billions of dollars that they found from the will that he had. He was a film director. He made movies like The Hell's Angels. He was an avid aviator. The American airlines industry owe a lot to him because he made some of the first planes in America. He was an avid aviator. He had a Casanova personality, but he was not just known for his wealth, he was also known for the reclusive lifestyle and the obsessive compulsive disorder that he had chronically suffered with. This man that I'm talking about is Howard Hughes. After his death in 1976, a movie was made, a movie that I just recently watched. Some of you may have watched this movie. The movie is called, that portrays his life, it's called The Aviator. It is played by this actor, a phenomenal actor, Leonardo DiCaprio. And Leonardo DiCaprio portrays the life of Howard Hughes as to who he was and kind of tries to capture the essence of this person But what was particularly puzzling to me as that movie ends is at the very end, of the movie, Leonardo DiCaprio, or who's playing Howard Hughes, starts to uncontrollably repeat this phrase, the way of the future, 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 to the point that it actually gets annoying to the audience that's watching this movie, where it says, the way of the future, the way of the future, the way of the future, and suddenly the director cuts the scene to a childhood scene of Howard Hughes, where Howard Hughes resolves to himself as a little child, as his mom is drying him up after his bath. Howard Hughes is telling himself, I will fly the fastest planes, I will make the biggest movies, and I will be the richest man in America. And then, the way of the future, as the ending credits roll on screen. Now, Howard Hughes was not very far from the truth when it came to the worldly way we look at the future. Since 1976, what he was saying is, I will fly the fastest plane. It's about being fast. We live today in a generation where information is processed in nanoseconds. He said, I will build the biggest planes. I'll make the biggest movies. The entertainment that we seek, the pleasure that we seek about everything being big today is not very far from what Howard Hughes was saying. Now, did he really say that phrase in his life? We don't know. It's attributed to him. The movie directors may have taken a dramatic license and said it, but he was not very far from the truth from the worldly standpoint. He also said, I will be the richest. It was about being fast, big, and rich, which sadly is not very different from the pursuits of many in the church. The church that should be diametrically opposite to the world, where we're not seeking to be fast, big, or rich, we seek many times to be in that same manner. But the scripture gives us a completely different viewpoint. The way of the future, according to the scripture, is not being fast, big, and rich. To answer that question, what does the Bible tell you and me about the way of the future? The answer is in that verse that we read. And behold, I come quickly. And my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall, be. From Revelation chapter 22, verse 12. The way of the future is different. So as I looked at this verse, I entitled my message, the message that we have today, is to watch and work. Watch, behold, I come quickly, and to give to every man according as his work shall be, so work. But as I was going through that verse, there is something in that verse that caught my attention, which is very critical and operative. If you look into that verse, can anyone tell me what is the one verse that you one word that you cannot ignore? I'll give you a clue. The New International Version completely omits it, unfortunately. The King James Version renders that word. So if you have a King James Version with you, what is the word that I'm looking for, which is critical for us to recognize that we cannot ignore? Behold. Before the word behold, there is the word and. It is not there in the New International Version, but in the King James Version it says, and behold, I come quickly. My reward is me to give unto every man according as his work shall be. Why is the word and so important? We learn in grade school KG through 1-2 that the word and is a conjunction. It adds something from something to something. Which means if the word starts with the words and behold, there is something before this final reminder that we need to pay attention to. And so what is it that this word is talking about? When we look at that verse and we dissect it, what is getting added to this final reminder that we need to watch and work? Scroll up a few verses and you will go to Revelation chapter 22, verse 7. It is the same saying of Jesus about his coming, where he says, "Behold, I come quickly, and blessed is everyone who keeps the sayings of the prophecies of this book." And when he says this to John, who has been brought this message by an angel of God, what John does is, John says, "And I saw, and I heard, and I heard, and after I had heard and seen, I fell down at the feet of the one who brought this word to me." And at that point, that angelic being says, "Stop it! What are you doing? I am a fellow servant of you and of the brethren of the prophets. I've been the servant, I've been messengers, I've been in service of God, to God, for God, to all the prophets that came before you. And I'm now that same fellow servant, and to everyone who keeps the sayings of this book. Worship God." So what is being added before we even get to watching for Christ is this thing about worshiping God. So when I started this message, so I was preparing for it, I started it by entitling it Watch and Work. But I had to quickly change that title to say Worship God and Watch and Work. It is the worshiping of God that comes first. What does it mean to worship God? It was a confirmation to me as I sat here and I was preparing myself to come up here, as they were singing from the choir. The very first song was, "Come, now is the time to worship," from Psalm 95. And then we saw later what the heart of worship was. It was all about Him. It is all about Jesus Christ. Nothing about me. Everything about Him. Worship is ascribing to Him His worthiness. What is He worthy of? Giving Him everything. In fact, the very first commandment of the Ten Commandments, as we know it, is what? "You shall have no other gods before me." The second commandment is, "You shall not make any idols." In the very first and second commandment, God establishes not just His position, not just His place, that He should be the first in your life and in my life, but He establishes the priority. But He doesn't stop there. He goes on to say there is no other gods, that it is not just priority that you're going to give to me. He didn't say you shall have me as the first God. He established His preeminence. Worship is giving unto God the preeminence that is due unto Him. To be able to worship God is to look at Him and say that I ascribe to you the first place, my utmost priority, and all of the preeminence that is due unto you. So how do we worship? How do we worship? The short answer to that question is essentially by our service. Now, why do I say that? Go back to Matthew chapter 4, when Jesus Christ was tempted. Satan takes Jesus, and he looks at Jesus, and he tells, and he shows Jesus all the glory of the land, all the kingdoms, all the glory that the world can give. It's important to recognize that, because that, if I was standing there, that would be a very alluring picture. All the glory of the land and all the kingdoms. And Satan tells him, "I will give this all unto you." The audacity that Satan had was that he first and foremost thought that that glory belonged to him. Now yes, he was kicked out from heaven and he was given to rule over, to be the prince of the air and to be having his dominion here on earth until Christ returns. But all that belongs to God. But Jesus Christ, from Philippians 2 we read, he did not think it was right to grasp that. But he made himself of no reputation. So he came down humbling himself, even unto the point of death. So he comes down here and Satan uses this against him to say, "I will give you all this glory, if only you fall down and worship me. Now Jesus Christ responded by wielding the sword of the Spirit, by using the word of God. And he said, it is written, get lost, Satan. I mean, he said in that, get thee hither away from me. Get lost, Satan. And then he said, you shall worship the Lord alone. But you know what? Jesus didn't stop there. If you look at the response that Jesus gave, he said, you shall worship none other but God alone, and only him will you serve. Satan didn't ask Jesus to serve him. Satan only asked him to worship him. Jesus responded by worship and service going hand in hand, two sides of the same coin. In our churches today, unfortunately, there are many Christians who are worshiping God and not serving. There are many who are serving God and not worshiping. Jesus is telling you and me, it is not about the things that you do for the church. First and foremost, worship and serve. Give me what is due unto me. Then go give unto others what I have given unto you. It is about worshiping and serving. So we see very first, from the very first part, that it is important for us to worship God and then to watch. Now watch, for I come quickly. Now it is important to recognize that before we even go to this aspect of watching for God, we need to have a desire, an aspiration to seek to see Him. Why is that important? Now if you look at that whole encounter that took place, where John gets these words, and he sees these things. You know what he says? And I saw and I heard, and after I had heard and seen. I was like, why is that repeated twice? I saw and I heard, and after I had heard and seen. Then he fell down to worship. Many of us are self-satisfied just hearing about Jesus. It's okay, he's another God, or he's a good man, or he's a God. You ask somebody who's a non-believer, what do you think about Jesus? He was a good man, I've heard about him. You ask Christians, yeah, he's the God of the Bible. Have you seen him? Have you experienced him? Do you experience him day after day, moment after moment? It is about seeing. My son, when he was little, he was probably 3 years old, Reuben asked me a question while we were driving. He asked, why did Zacchaeus climb the tree? Now my immediate answer to him was, because he was short. Right? You think there were no other short people in that whole town? So I go back and as I reminisced on that question and my response to my son, I realized that the answer to what my son was asking is actually there in the scripture. Luke chapter 19 verse 3 says, and Zacchaeus sought to see Jesus. He heard that Jesus was passing by his town and he sought to see. He in fact runs ahead, climbs up the sycamore tree, and then you know what the fascinating part of that whole account is? Is when Jesus comes to that place, Jesus looks up and sees Zacchaeus. And Jesus responds and he tells Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, for I must come to your house. And later in that account, we see that salvation came to the household of Zacchaeus. You may have heard about the saying, if you seek him, you will find him. How many of you have heard that? If you seek him, you will find him. The account of Zacchaeus actually tells us, if you seek him, he will find you. He will find you. And he will look at you. He will look at you and he will say, come down from whatever pedestal you put yourself up on. From the worldly perspective, make haste, come quickly. For I must come into your life. And only then salvation will be found in that house. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice, let him hear and open the door. Let him open his life so that I can come in and sup with him and commune with him. Only then, in Christ, coming into the lives of individuals is salvation experienced. So you see the IRS guy that was up the tree that had to come down. and salvation was found in. So we need to seek to see. And then I said, we need to watch. We need to watch for Christ. What do we need to watch for Christ? Because after resurrection, the first thing that happened, or one of the first things that happened, was he appeared. Acts chapter 1 verse 3 says that he appeared to many with infallible proofs of his resurrection. But then Acts chapter 1 verse 9 says that not only did he appear, he ascended up to heaven. But when he ascended in the midst of everyone to whom he had appeared, there were two men in white who were standing in their presence. So there was an appearance, there was an ascension, but then there was an announcement. And the men said, why do you stand here and look? For this Jesus that you see going up into heaven will in same manner, in likewise manner, return. So an announcement was made of his return in the very point when he was leaving this earth to ascend, to go to sit at the right hand of God. So we need to watch for Christ because an announcement has been made. At the same time, we need to watch out for all the others who claim to be Christ. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24, verse 23 and 24, many will come in my name, claiming I am he. Don't get deceived. There are many false Christs that will come, like they are the means to salvation. They are the means to your ultimate peace. Watch out so that you don't get deceived. So we watch for the Christ to return. We watch out for the false Christ so that we don't get deceived. And as we watch, how can we be so sure to know Jesus when he returns? We've got to go back to the scripture to get the answer. The scripture is very explicit. It says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 27, as lightning when it comes in the east is seen in the west, so shall it be when the Son of Man comes, which means when he comes, he will come for all to see, and every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So he's not going to come hidden in one place, or he's going to be here or there. When he comes, the world will have a day of reckoning that this is the Lord God appearing again. So he'll come for all to see. He will come speedily. The verse that we read is, behold, I come quickly. He'll come speedily. But not only will he come speedily, he will come splendidly. Matthew chapter 24 gives us that when the Son of Man comes, in chapter verse 29 and 20, 29 and 30, it tells us when the Son of Man comes, with the power of his coming, the heavens will be shaken. And he will come with great power and great glory. We will see Jesus Christ magnified as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords above all things. He'll come back as a king. And so we see that he will come not only for all to see, he'll come so that all can see, he'll come speedily, he'll come splendidly, but he'll also come stealthily. That is the reason why we need to be on guard. He will come not stealthily as he wants to trick you that you won't know when he's coming, but he will come stealthily when no man is expecting. For not even the angels know of the hour that is to come, and the Lord will come. He makes that very clear. But only the Father. And he will come stealthily, like a thief in the night. So if I could borrow the words from one of my favorite singers, a guy named Cliff Richard. Some of you may have heard about him. Cliff Richards, he sang a song called Thief in the Night. If I could borrow his lyrics, I'll illustrate something that I think we need to all recognize. So he says, I could talk for hours and you wouldn't hear a word. Your own opinions make you blind. But there will come a morning when the sand has all run out. There will be no more time to change your mind. For like a thief in the night, he will come. There will be nowhere left for us to run. You can fall in that night, or you can rise with the sun. He will come in glory, a rider in the sky. The lion and the lamb rest side by side. children of his kingdom, he will gather to himself. Children of the darkness, he will leave behind. For like a thief in the night, he will come. There will be nowhere left for us to run. You can fall in the night, or you can rise with the sun. Let me dissect that a little bit for you as we analyze those lyrics. He will come in glory. When he comes, he will come as a knight in shining armor. The only difference is that when he comes to wage war as a knight in shining armor, Revelation chapter 19 verse tells us that his armor will be a vesture that is dipped in blood. He will come as the faithful and true. He will come with a name that is King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. When he comes, there will be great power and great glory. For he'll come in glory, a rider in the sky. 19th chapter of Revelation again. It tells us that he will come on a white horse. And his name is faithful and true. So we see him come in glory, a rider in the sky. The lion and the lamb rest side by side. The first time Jesus Christ set foot on earth, he came as the Agnus Dei, as the Lamb of God. John the Baptist's proclamation about Jesus Christ was, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." He came as a lamb. The next time he's coming as a lion, as the Lion of the tribe of Judah, as the King over all. If you look into the account that is given in Revelation chapter 5, there is nobody that is worthy to open, take the book out of the right hand of God and to open it or break its seals thereof. And you notice over there where the elder is telling John, "Weep not, for behold, I see a lion of the tribe of Judah." And when John looks and he sees, what does he see? He doesn't see a lion. He sees in the midst of the throne of God a lamb as if it was slain. The lion and the lamb in perfect harmony. Savior as lamb, king as a lion. That is Jesus Christ. Rest side by side. Isaiah chapter 26 verse 5 says that he who has his minds stayed on Christ, on him, on God, will have perfect peace. Resting side by side, the lion and the lamb is a symbolic representation of tranquility, of perfect peace. And only in Jesus Christ you find that peace, because he said, "The peace I give unto you, the world cannot give, for this peace passeth all understanding." And so we see that he will come, and children of the kingdom. Who are the children of his kingdom? It is not everybody in the church. It is everybody in the church who have accepted the lordship and the kingship of Jesus Christ. It is important for us to recognize. How do we know that? We know that from the thief on the cross, the penitent thief on the cross, when he actually asked Jesus, what did he ask Jesus to do? He said, "Lord, remember me when you come into thy kingdom." If you actually read that account carefully, you will notice something. Before that statement was ever made by that penitent thief, he actually scolded the other rebellious thief and he told him, "You know what? We deserve this thing. But this man Christ, what has he done?" Recognize that? Do you catch it? He referred to Christ as a man as he was hanging on the cross. He said, "This man Christ, what has he done?" And then when he realized his unworthiness and the Lamb of God alongside him bearing his sin, he didn't refer to him anymore as a man, and he said, "Lord, remember me when you come into thy kingdom." Many of us look at Christ as just a man. It is important for us to first see him as Savior and Lord, and then to see him as a King, for he comes into his kingdom. So we see the the lion and the lamb, the children of the kingdom, he will gather to himself so that we may be where he is also. And that is the words of Jesus Christ. I am going to prepare a place for you so that you may be where I am. So you can take him at his word. If you've accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord over your life and as King to reign in your life. And then we see children of the darkness, he will leave behind. Who are those who are in the darkness? He's going to leave them behind. Let me tell you a scene from another movie that I like to watch. Every time it's on, I watch it. I enjoy that movie. It's a good movie. It's called Scent of a Woman. It's a story of a lieutenant colonel who is blind. The character is played by Al Pacino. And Al Pacino is playing this fantastic scene. I mean, the whole movie is a classic movie. And he's this colonel who is blind, who's getting ready to end his life by shooting himself. And as this colonel is about to do it, for that weekend, just before he wants to end his life, he's hired this high school prep guy who is a guy named Charlie Sims. And Charlie Sims is played by Chris O'Donnell, another good actor. And so Chris O'Donnell, as he's this prep school guy, watching out and watching for this colonel and tending to his needs through that weekend. Just for that weekend, he's hired him. And Charlie realizes that this colonel is going to do something and he's trying to end his life. So he goes and stops him from killing himself. And then Charlie scolds the colonel and he tells the colonel, the dialogue goes something like this. So you messed up, all right? So what? So everybody does it. Everybody messes up. Get on with your life, would you? The colonel screaming. Now I wish I could do an Al Pacino impression. I guess I'm not as good an actor as he is. But if you watch it, the colonel responds and he says and he screams, "What life? I'm so freaking blind. I'm in the dark, you understand? I'm in the dark." To the blind man, everything was dark. If I was to draw that analogy to our life, so what? Everybody has messed up. Every one of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. The wages of sin is death. We all deserve that. But we need to get on with life. And Jesus Christ said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except by me. If you believe in me, even though you are dead, yet you shall live. Because I am the resurrection and the life." Jesus Christ is life. We need to get on with him. But unfortunately, there are many like that colonel in the world today that are still screaming and crying out and seeking for an answer and saying, "I'm in the dark, you understand? I am in the dark." Because the God of this world has blinded the minds of many lest they see the glorious truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ to shine upon them. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. The God of this world has blinded the minds of many. Which takes us to the very last part of having watched out for him, to watch for him, to working for him. What is it that we should be doing? We are called to be ambassadors for Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. We're called to be ambassadors on this reconciling mission where we reconcile men to God. But it is not our doing. How do we do this really? Is it by the words we speak? Or more so by the lives we live? Hidden in us, 2 Corinthians 4:7 says, hidden in us is this treasure of the excellency of the power of God. Hidden in us is Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Hidden in us is this beautiful treasure, this gospel of the light of Christ. Is that light being shown through? Or is our shell of life so dirty that he cannot be seen through us? You know, we need to break. like the lady who broke the alabaster jar that was of high expensive perfume, the high expensive treasure that is in us. We need to break with humility at the foot of the cross. We need to break so that people will see Christ in us. And through our lives, people will know. Because Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey me. And in your obedience, will people know that you are my disciples. So through our lives, without a single word being spoken, we can still be a witness and serve God and work for him. Now it is important for us to go on to the very last part of that verse and to recognize that we need to work for God. But why is it that we need to work for God? The Bible says because our reward is with him. So we work for our reward. Everybody agree with me? And I'm sorry. It actually caught me off guard when I actually read that phrase. Our reward is not with him. The scripture says, and my reward is with me. It is Jesus' reward. It is not your reward. It is not my reward. It is not because of the things we have done or the things we will do that he's going to come and give us a bonus or a reward. My reward is with me, which is a picture of perfect grace that I will give unto you what I own, not because you deserve it, but because I love you. My reward is with me. We are not entitled to anything. I've got news for every one of us. Naked arrival, naked departure. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Naked did we come, naked shall we go. There is nothing that you and I are entitled to. In fact, if I was reminded as I was preparing of my son when he was about 2 years old or close to about three, he had just come back from daycare, and in daycare they taught him about taking care of his property, right, of all the things that you need to take care of and put back in your shelves and all that stuff. And so while I was telling Reuben one day, I said, hey Reuben, can you go clean your room, clean the game room? He was kind of slow, so I was going to help him lift his stuff and put it away, and as I just reached out to him, he looks at me and he goes, my property. So, you know, like he didn't say property because he said it was property. And I understood what he was saying, and I look at him and I go, son, you are my property. So what you own, I own. Many times, we are like that two-year-old. We think what God has given unto us, the houses, the cars, or the job, or anything and everything that's materialistic, is my property. We don't own anything. We're not entitled to anything. It is his reward. He will give unto us. Why? So we work because it is his reward to give every man according as his work shall be. So let's look at that verse and let's look at that phrase and dissect it. There are two hidden truths that come from that phrase. The first hidden truth that comes from the phrase is that God is first a giver. To give unto every man according as his work shall be. God has been giving since time began. He continues to give. He will continue to give grace to the point, at one point, when there will be no more grace to be given. And that is when he will come. That will be the day of reckoning. So he gives, and we're glad that we're in this time of grace, where we can experience the fullness of God in Jesus Christ, because he's still a giver, and he will come to give. So God is first a giver. I went to school, in the state of Tamil Nadu, from grade 1 to grade 4. I studied in the school called Santosha Vidyalaya. It's in the Tirunelveli district, and it's in a place called Donavu. It was known among the missionary families because it was a missionary school. Missionary children, kids of missionaries used to go to the school. The school was actually founded and one of the leading ladies who was a missionary, a Protestant missionary, who had come to India was a lady by name Amy Carmichael. Amy Carmichael, some of you may have heard about her, read her biography, or read about her. But Amy had a very interesting saying. She used to be known as the beloved Amma of Donavur, and she died and she's buried in Donavur, where she went to be a missionary for Jesus Christ. So she was there, and she made a very interesting saying. She said this: you can give without loving. but you cannot love without giving. We can give what we have without an ounce of love. But if you love Jesus Christ, he asked three times to Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? In essence, he was asking, do you give yourself? Do you give every person, everything, everything that is important to you, do you give your all? We cannot love God without giving. God so loved the world that he gave. Giving is the expression of love. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. So you see that God is first a giver. And the second hidden truth that is in there is the fact, and again, it's unfortunate that the NIV doesn't render it the way it should be, but the NIV actually renders it as the work that has been done. Whereas read carefully, the King James Version actually renders it as the work shall be. This is talking not about works that you have done to receive a reward. This is talking about the work that is in the future, that we shall be servants of the King when he returns. Revelation chapter 22 verse 3 establishes the fact that there will be no more curse and his servants shall serve him. We don't know what manner of service we will have, but we know if you go and look at the parables that Jesus said, to them that were faithful in little things, he gave them more. So there will be some kind of service that we will be doing unto God. But it is also important to recognize that that word, work, is singular. Not according to the works that one has done, but according to the work as shall be. Work is singular. When Jesus Christ returns, there will be only one and one thing that will be important for us to do, which is to worship God and serve him. Worship God and serve him. The 24 elders at the foot, they fell down before the Lamb, and they said, blessing and honor and glory and power and riches be unto you forever and ever and ever. They were worshiping God and they were serving, and we serve him just in that same manner. So it is important for us to first recognize that it's singular, it is one work that we do. And also, it is important for us to recognize and counsel ourselves that if you don't get into the habit of serving him today, when he comes, it may be a big surprise as to how you would serve him. So let's practice serving God today and waiting, because we will be serving him if you accepted him as Lord and Savior. So, as we come towards the end of this message, in conclusion, the way of the future is Jesus Christ coming to reign over all. That is the way of the future. The way of the future begins now when we worship God and watch for his coming and work. Work as being ambassadors, broken, denying self, dying to sin. That is the way of the future. If I may take the liberty, not necessarily to add anything to the scripture or subtract anything from the scripture, but if it was to be rewritten, that verse, I believe Jesus Christ would say, worship God and watch, for I come quickly. And my reward is with me to give unto every man according as his work shall be. We need to worship God, we need to watch, and we need to work. So the application of what we've heard today. Are you and I ascribing unto God the worthiness that he deserves? Are you and I worshiping him and serving him? Two sides of the same coin. Are you and I watching for him to return as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? In all of his majesty, in all of his glory, are we watching for him to come to reign? When he will come for all the world to see, he will come speedily, he will come splendidly, he will come stealthily, like a thief in the night. And children of the darkness he will leave behind. Children of his kingdom he will gather to himself. Don't think this message is for someone else. Someone else should be listening to this. But are you ready? Am I ready to receive the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? We can cheat humans. We can't cheat God. Everything is open unto Him. So are you and I ready? No amount of good works will get us to heaven, but God works to get us to heaven. Let me tell you from Matthew 25. Interestingly, Matthew chapter 25 has one of the last parables of Jesus, of the parable of the 10 virgins. And that parable was said after Matthew chapter 24, in which Jesus is actually giving the Olivet's discourse all about the times of the end times, or the signs of the end times. So after he talks about his coming, as how the Son of Man will come, then he takes and he talks about, Matthew records in the Gospel in chapter 25, he says and he tells about the 10 virgins. 10 virgins, 10 lamps, 5 filled, 5 empty, 5 wise, 5 foolish. 10 virgins, what does that mean? Every one of them were undefiled. They were all pure. There was no blemish. But not every one of them went to be with the bridegroom when he came. It is not the purity that is in us that makes us get into heaven. No amount of good works. Our righteousness are like filthy rags. So we can be pure. Good works, not going to help. But the 5 who were prepared and they had the oil in the lamp so that the light could shine out of the lamp is akin to our lives when we accept Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit of God, which is the oil that showcases Jesus Christ, as you would see in Zechariah chapter 4. It talks about the oil that was being poured out. And they said these were the anointed ones. The Holy Spirit has to be in you as the oil before you can actually showcase that light of the gospel of Jesus Christ, before you can showcase Christ to the world. And if you believed in His name, you are given the Holy Spirit to seal us unto the day when the day of reckoning will come. And so the Holy Spirit will present us, Jesus and His Spirit will present us blameless before the throne of God. So when God the Father looks at you and me, He doesn't see you and me as sinner, but He sees you and me. But before us, He sees Jesus Christ the Savior, and He's willing to pardon us. If you believed and you accepted the Holy Spirit, that oil is in us, and that oil is what makes you ready. Don't be foolish not having that oil. You can go through your entire life sitting in a church and not have that oil in you, not having ever believed in Jesus Christ or having accepted. So when the bridegroom came, only 5 were taken to enjoy and to enjoy the joy of the kingdom. So are you ready? One of the most important, one of the most critical questions that each one of you should answer, which means, have I believed? Have I accepted Jesus Christ? Like that thief who first understood and recognized his unworthiness. I deserve this thing, he said. We all should recognize and acknowledge that we are sinners. Believe, for he who believes shall not perish but have everlasting life. And confess, for if you confess with your mouth, He is faithful and just to cleanse us of all unrighteousness and to impute on us His very own righteousness. To be able to clothe us with that white robes of righteousness which has been dipped in blood because Jesus Christ hung on the cross for you and me. So are you ready? Am I ready? And finally, are you and I willing to work? Start working now so it won't be a surprise when we have to work for Him and serve Him in His kingdom. Think of a way, practically, that you can leave from here and go and be a servant of Christ. For who is greatest? Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? It is he who serves his brethren and sisters. To be a servant first is what gets you position in heaven. But not without salvation experience of where you've accepted Jesus Christ. So with that said, these next moments are very, very solemn because it's God and you in dialogue. Don't think of me as being a person who's asking you to do something. But take the moment to ask yourself, if there is anybody over here who's heard the word of God and is telling yourself today, Lord, I have been serving you, but not really worshiping you. I have been worshiping you, but not really serving you. If there's anyone over here that is wanting to make that change and recognize, Lord, let me worship you first and serve you. I pray that you would either stand up or raise your hands, but take that moment, that introspection. I'm the first to stand up and say, Lord, I'm guilty of not having given you all the worthiness, but I'm already standing. So don't be ashamed to show that you are willing to take the stand for Christ. So take a moment, introspect. And then if there is anybody over here that is thinking, Lord, am I really ready? Am I really ready? Do I see that you're going to be coming soon? And from that standpoint, have I accepted you as my Lord and Savior, as my Savior and King? If there's anyone over here who never made that commitment and want to make that commitment today, you can pray that prayer in your heart. You can stand to express, or you can raise your hands, or you can just say, Lord, it is between you and me. I am saying that you are my Savior and my God. And finally, if there is anyone over here who's made that commitment to serve starting today, Lord, I want to be your servant so that when you come to reign, it won't be a surprise to me. I pray that you will stand. Physically, it doesn't matter, but stand spiritually. If you want to express it standing physically, that is fine too. But you need to make that stand today. It is important for us to recognize that He is the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. And what He is saying is, and behold, I come quickly. He said, if you're ashamed of me before men, I will be ashamed of you before the Father. If we can't take a stand for Him in the church, how are we going to take a stand for Him outside the church? And behold, I come quickly. And my reward is with me, to give every man according as His work shall be. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Loving God and Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this time. I pray as you have spoken, that we will listen and we will respond. Not with our lips, but with our lives. That we would not hear just with our ears, but with our hearts. And I pray, Lord, that you will be glorified, and that we will watch out for the false Christ, watching for the Christ to return. That we will worship you first, we'll watch for you, and you return. Help us not to be caught unguarded. Help us not to be caught off guard. But Lord, we pray that when you come like a thief in the night, we will be partakers of the kingdom, we'll be children of the kingdom, for we believe and we accept that Jesus Christ is Lord over all, that you are King to return, that you are Savior and King with the Lion and the Lamb, and you keep in perfect peace all whose minds are stayed on you. We pray, Lord, as our hearts are given in service and dedication to serve you, that you will show us the means and the mechanisms, and that you will give us the boldness to be able to stand up for you and to serve you, to be your children. I come at this time asking you, Lord Jesus, that you will be exalted and you will be glorified, and that, Lord Jesus, you will increase and we will decrease. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, God's only Son, we pray this prayer. Amen.